Not think it, but the Isle of Man is one of the most interesting places geologically in the whole of the British Isles. And you only have to come to a place like this, Scarlet, in the south of the island to see what I mean. The main rock here is limestone, formed around 330 million years ago, when the Isle of Man was way south of here, near the equator. And I bet you some days you wish it was still there. Like the rest of the Earth's crust, the island has been constantly moving and reforming. And as the area drifted northwards towards where it is today over hundreds of millions of years, the layers of rocks were twisted by the huge forces involved, and you can see the results of that here at Scarlet. When this rock was formed, there was little actual land above water. Instead, the area was a shallow tropical sea where the shells of countless organisms collected on the seabed. Over time, this material hardened to form the rock we know as limestone, and the remains of the larger organisms can be seen in the rock as fossils. The most common are crinoids, a type of sea lily related to the sea urchin, and you can see bits of their tube-like stems in the rocks here. The limestone made millions of years ago has been very useful more recently. It quarries easily and is an excellent building material, and in fact, much of nearby Castletown is built from limestone that was quarried from right here. Castle Russian dominates the town, and like many buildings around it, is made of limestone from the Scarlet quarries. Nearby, King William's College is also built from this distinctive grey stone. You can burn the stone as well and get a powder which farmers like to spread on the land as fertiliser, lime. Here at Scarlet are the remains of huge lime kilns that were used for that purpose. And just over there was a jetty where boats would pull in and take away the stone for building, and the lime for farmers. But there's much more to see here than just some old limestone, because this is lava. When the limestone was forming underwater, there were often volcanic eruptions, and this lava wall is the remains of one of them. It's an extraordinary landscape, and it's got some interesting features. If you look closely at this rock, you can see tiny vesicles, small holes where bubbles of gas were released in the molten lava. And here you can see that as the lava was flowing, it has carried along pieces of other rocks which have been set into it, like currants in a cake. The most striking feature is what is known as the stack. This was a plug of lava in one of the vents of the volcano which, when it cooled, formed into columns of basalt, one of the types of volcanic rock. And there's even more here. About 65 million years ago, the Atlantic Ocean began to form, when what we now know as North America tore apart from Europe. The Earth's crust cracked and molten magma began to flow up. And this is one of those cracks. They're called dikes. And if you're wondering why there's no magma in this dike, it's because the sea has eroded it all away. But the huge upheaval between America and Europe has left other scars on the island, which are quite extraordinary.
Many of you may recognise this place from the film Waking Ned. That was Ned's cottage where he was found inside clutching the winning lottery ticket. But what you might not know is that down here, you're very close to America. This is a very exciting spot for geologists because this is where two continents collided. And round here, there is a fracture in the rock that marks the spot. And this is that fracture line. Now, to understand all of this, we have to go back about 500 million years. At that time, the Earth's landmass was made up of two huge supercontinents called Gondwana and Laurentia. Gondwana was in the south and incorporated what is today southern England, Africa and Antarctica. Laurentia was up in the north and incorporated what is now Scotland, North America and the Arctic. And they were separated by a massive ocean the size of the present-day Pacific. Now, over a period of about 100 million years, the ocean began to close up, and these two huge supercontinents collided, forming a mountain range which originally stretched from North America right across to Scandinavia. And believe it or not, this fracture line is where the two continents met. So, in effect, if I stand over here, I'm standing on a continent that forms North America, and if I stand over here, I'm standing on the continent that forms Africa. Who needs to travel abroad?
The island is actually made up of a number of types of rock. As well as the limestone and volcanic rock at Scarlet, there's sandstone in the west at Peel and granite at Foxdale. But at least three quarters of the island is made up of slate, formed from sediments on the floor of an ancient ocean and consisting of a varying mixture of mudstones, siltstones, sandstones, quartzites and slates. These ancient rocks were subjected to huge pressures which folded them up into mountains which have moved with the continents and have been weathered by the wind, rain and the sea.
Of course, all these upheavals happened over millions of years, but there are changes to the Manx landscape which are much more recent. About 18,000 years ago, a lengthy ice age was coming to an end, and the changes that the ice had on the Manx landscape during this period were enormous. There was a huge ice sheet that had come down from Scotland, and it was scouring the hills and pushing before it millions of tons of soil, stones and gravel. And it was only when that ice began to melt that the real changes began to take place.
The valley around the Druidale area above Sulby is actually filled with the material the glaciers left behind. Before the Ice Age, the valley would have been quite deep, but now it's completely covered over.
Standing here, you can clearly see what has happened. This is the original side of the valley from before the Ice Age, and it comes down at this angle. But over there, a huge pile of soil and gravel has been dumped on top of it, and the original valley floor is now buried deep underneath it.
Thousands of years of rain and the action of the rivers are eroding the soils, and if you follow the river, you can see how it is cutting into the deposits down to the original valley floor. Scientists have done seismic surveys over this area, and these show that in some places the covering is up to 160 metres deep.
The Great Ice Age did something even more dramatic for the Isle of Man. It made it bigger. Before the ice came, around 70,000 years ago, this whole northern plain of the island didn't exist. And if the sea level then was the same as it is now, which it probably was, then this line of hills would have marked the coastline, and the sea would have been lapping up at their base.
In fact, a map of the island at that time would have looked something like this: no northern point. After the ice retreated, it left behind so much material that 10,000 years ago, the island probably looked something like this. Nowadays, the familiar shape of the island is like this, so clearly some of it has disappeared since the last ice age.
That disappearance of part of the land is probably the most fascinating part of the island's recent history, and it's beginning to have a dramatic effect on the people who live on this northern plain. So let's find out more about that. We've seen how the rocks of the Isle of Man have been formed over hundreds of millions of years. And there's a variety of types. There's limestone, lava, granite and so on. But this northern part of the island is quite different and, geologically speaking, much more recent. You know, there's a story about two glowworms living in a huge American redwood tree. One glowworm turns to the other and says, "You know, they say these things actually grow." "Nah," said the other glowworm, "I've lived here all my life and I've never seen it move." And that is just like our relationship with the Earth. It's taken hundreds of millions of years for the continents to shift and for the rocks to twist and turn. But because we only live for a few short years, we assume nothing's happening and that it's all finished.
The reality is, though, that the Earth is still changing at the same speed it's always done. It's just that it's so slow, we can't see it. But there are exceptions to this, and here on the Isle of Man is one of the best places to see a landscape changing and reforming. And if you know where to look, there's a lot to see. For a start, there's lots of evidence around from the last ice age. We know the ice pushed down from the north, from Scotland, and actually there's quite a bit of Scotland left here on the beaches.
This stone, for example, with its distinctive blue flecks, is a piece of granite from Ailsa Craig. That's a huge granite outcrop in the sea north of the Mull of Galloway. Such a stone is called an erratic, and it shouldn't be here. It's only here because the massive ice sheet pushed all the loose stone and gravel in front of it when it marched south thousands of years ago.
Standing by this cliff here is like being next to a layer cake of time. Thousands of years of history are here in a single glance. At the bottom are layers of clay and deposits left by the ice as its waters melted and carried materials past here. Above it, like a layer of chocolate, we can see a line of peat from a period when there was a lot of vegetation here, which died and rotted and was compressed. This happened about 3,500 years ago, although the actual process would have only gone on for about 1,000 years. Above this, evidence of human habitation from the Bronze Age 3,000 years ago. Flecks of charcoal in the silt from a river that once ran here indicate that early man burnt wood here, probably for cooking or keeping warm. Some of the stones used for cooking are also here, left where they were dumped before material covered them up. On the very top, the modern soil and grass used by the present-day farmers.
So all this is courtesy of the great ice sheet pushing the material down from the north or simply melting. But it's important to realise that when this was happening, the coastline was actually several miles out from here. And since then, the sea has eroded away huge chunks of land. And these ancient people would have been living quite a bit inland. Now, the erosion is something we'll be looking at in a moment, but first, let's look at some of the other features the ice left behind.
Just south of Kirkmichael is a mysterious dry valley. It certainly looks like an old riverbed, but where's the water? Well, this valley was once filled by a torrent of water. In fact, it was the river that cut it through the landscape. 10,000 years ago, the water melting off the ice-covered hills behind formed a huge lake where the road to Kirkmichael now runs, the TT course. To find its way to the sea, the water rushed over this hill, which was one of the sides of the lake. For many centuries, this river flowed down to the sea, and you can follow its channel to the coast. On the northern coast, running up to the Point of Ayr, there are some strange features as well. These cliffs were once right on the edge of the sea, but now they are set well back and the sea doesn't come anywhere near them. Given that so much of the coast seems to be vanishing around here, how has this happened?
Well, the reason that these cliffs no longer meet the sea is quite extraordinary, and it's all to do with isostatic rebound, not something you hear about every day.
Now, the first thing to realise is that when this land was covered in ice, which some experts think could have been up to 750 metres thick, the weight on it was enormous, hundreds of millions of tonnes, and it actually pushed the land down into the Earth's crust. But when the ice melted, the weight was gone, and the land began to slowly rise up again. It's a slow process, and the sea levels have changed during this period. Nevertheless, all this land is very slowly rising, causing what is known as a raised beach. The sea can't get to these cliffs anymore. Perhaps the most spectacular remnant of the last ice age is to be seen here at Shelleg Point, a couple of kilometres north of Ramsey. Here there is a towering sand cliff which is eroding away into the sea, and if it wasn't for the ice, it wouldn't be here.
If you can picture the mountains in Scotland way up north there during the last ice age, then you can imagine there was a huge amount of snow falling on the top of them, which was freezing to form ice, and the weight of which was pushing down and pushing out a huge ice sheet across the British Isles. Now this ice sheet pushed forward and retreated several times over a period of about 60,000 years, and the last time that it pushed forward, it stopped right there, and look at what it left behind. If you can imagine that the front of this block is like the front of the ice sheet, then you can see that as it pushed forward, it collected up a huge amount of sand and gravel in front of it. And as the ice retreated, it left a massive ridge. And that hill is one of those ridges.
In fact, it's one of the most spectacular examples of the last push of an ice sheet that you'll find anywhere. And if you look down on the area, you can see other features as well. As the ice started to melt and retreat, its waters eroded the material it had brought with it, making valleys and rounding the hills. These folds and valleys are distinctive from the air, and this range of hills actually runs across a good deal of the northern plain, marking the line where the ice stopped.
The waters from the melting ice weren't the only force at work on this northern plain. There's a much more powerful force that's still at work today, the sea. And although it may look calm this afternoon, I can assure you it's causing a lot of problems for a lot of people. We've seen how all the sand and gravel that makes up the north of the Isle of Man was left by the retreating ice, which finally melted around 18,000 years ago. And since then, the wind, the rain, and the sea have all done their best to try and remove this material. And now, in the 21st century, land and property is being threatened like never before. And it's the sea that's doing more than anything else to change this northern part of the island. And we can measure the destruction year by year.
After the ice retreated, there was probably much more land here than there is now. The coast could have been up to 4 kilometres further out, even as recently as 5,000 years ago. The sea is an unpredictable and relentless force, and year after year it has been eating away at the base of these cliffs, washing the sand and clay away and causing the tops to slump down. You can easily see the results of this slumping. Fences hang in the air, and field drainage pipes discharge their water onto the sand below. Areas of grass are also visible. These were once the surface of the fields, now sliding down to the sea.
Obviously, this is having a dramatic effect on the people who live around here. Not only is valuable farmland being lost, thousands of metres have been lost to the sea already, but property is also threatened.
Who knows how many buildings have fallen into the sea in the past centuries? We know of some farms, cottages, a church and a mill in the past two centuries, and there are some that are actually threatened today. This is Carlin Mill, now a private house, but the main part of the building was built as a mill some 500 years ago. At that time, it would have been a safe distance from the sea. The little stream nearby provided water to turn the miller's wheel. But things are very different now. Just over 10 years ago, at the front of the house, there was a lovely long garden. But then, in one viciously stormy night, the sea ripped vast amounts of land from along this coast, and over the following weeks, the owner had to watch his garden gradually disappear. Since then, it's been a fight to save the property. The owner of Carlin Mill is David Greenwood, and he recalls that fateful storm.
We had two storms. One was the 25th of January, and the second one the 26th of February. 1990. The 26th of February, we're having breakfast one morning, 8 o'clock, weather forecast, and as you know, they give the rough to very rough, so on, and this morning it was very high to phenomenal. Never heard it before, never heard it since. I just said to one, what the hell's coming today? And we just moved the furniture back, waited for it, and it whipped in, and, you know, we are still here, but we've done a lot of work, you know, since those days.
How much garden did you actually lose here?
We had to move out of the house. We lost something like 30 yards of land in a month. It didn't all go in one night, but near enough 30 days, we more or less lost it. 30 yards is a lot. We've only left with 22 now. Behind me, you'll see the rocks out at sea, and towards the end of those rocks, that was near enough our land.
That's yeah. Where your garden used to
near,
stretch to.
Near enough, yeah, within a few feet. The other point is that when we had the 52 yards of land, you could walk to the edge and you could actually just crouch down and jump off onto the beach, which was 7-8 feet maybe. Yeah. You can see now behind me. And what's happened is the actual beach level has gone down several feet. I've had the government people up and they came here and realised that the beach levels are actually going down. So you can see behind me, you wouldn't jump down now onto the beach. But that's how it was, about 7-8 feet we could jump onto the beach.
What do you think the government should do about protecting the coastal area of this northern plain?
That's a difficult one, isn't it? What we think they should do and what they actually do. I honestly think we're just left on our own.
But you've had to pay for all of this defensive work yourself.
We pay for everything, yeah.
Today, Mr. Greenwood's house stands surrounded by his fortifications, putting a defiant face to the sea. But who knows how long they will last?
Another property nearby that is threatened is Ballatier. It's a small farm on the top up there. And here too, the owner has taken things into his own hands. He's placed gabions along the base of the cliff to protect it. And they've been completely wrecked by the sea.
Gabions are giant wire baskets filled with stones. And they've recently been used on the mountain road to protect it from landslips. They are usually a strong and effective way of stabilising land.
That is until the sea gets to them. Here they've been tossed around like so many pebbles. The sea will not be defied.
Worse still, they have an effect on the sea currents, causing swirling eddies in the water, which have an even worse effect on the erosion. Aerial photography taken 2 years ago shows that the gabions were in relatively good condition, and they seem to be offering some protection to Ballater on the cliff above. But the storms of the last 2 years have wreaked havoc on the baskets, and who knows how long they'll last. But it's not only the sea that is causing erosion around here. All the way down this coast, there are great cuts in the cliffs where rivers join the sea. Over thousands of years, they have been eroding their way through the sand cliffs, carrying away material and dumping it on the beaches. Rather than threatening landowners, some people have taken advantage of this.
The garden of this house just south of Kirkmichael is particularly flat, and that's because it used to be a riverbed formed thousands of years ago. Now, since then, the river's taken a different course, and we can see it from round the back here. This garden is what's known as a river terrace. That is, a level which the river settled at for a while before something made it change its course and it began to erode into the land over there.
From above, you can see the huge valley the river eventually cut, and on the left, the house with the flat garden where the river once flowed. But it's the sea that's still having the most dramatic effect on the coast. And just north of here, a whole village is threatened. Is it now time for the government to get involved? Kirkmichael is finding itself just that bit closer to the beach every year. And there's obvious concern that someday soon, the very houses and streets of the village will be threatened. But what action can be taken to stop the sea? And how much would it cost? There are already some attempts to stop the sea eroding the coast here using blocks of granite, but they can't save the village.
Well, when in doubt, call the consultants. And that's just what the Manx government did in 2000 when they engaged consulting engineers Posworth de Vivier and asked them to come and look at the whole problem of coastal erosion and report back with some recommendations. And the man who commissioned that report, the then Minister for Transport, the Honourable Tony Brown MHK, is waiting just up here to talk to us.
Mr Brown is now the Speaker of the House of Keys, but it was his recommendations in the Tymwell debate that helped formulate government policy on coastal erosion. And given the consultants identified a number of houses that will fall into the sea within the next 12 years, wasn't some urgent action needed?
Well, no, I mean, we looked at the situation and said, really, for those properties, there's very little could be done without considerable expense. And what, in fact, happened was the report that Tynwald had received and adopted was, in fact, that we should try and manage the situation.
As a caring government, do you not think that the government should compensate landowners for their property which is being lost to the sea?
Well, government's always taken the view that that was not their role, and in fact it's not unique to the Isle of Man, that's a view generally held throughout Europe. The situation is that either people have either lived there for generations and the erosion's gone on for hundreds of years, it's nothing new, or they've built there in recent times knowing that in fact they're building in an area where there's potential erosion. So I think we have to balance all that up and take a view, a realistic view really, as to what is the responsibility of government on land it doesn't own. In an area where, in fact, the only responsibility to have is in relation to the high water mark and the low water mark. So when you look into all the pros and cons, the only thing we can try and do is say no more development must go past a certain line. And that's been in the Kirkmichael local plan now for quite a number of years. So development of housing or of any property can't happen past a certain line.
The report states that Kirkmichael will be under threat in approximately 150 years. Are you not being complacent in just allowing future generations to sort out the problem?
Now, I think timing is important, and I think whether we like it or not, future generations are going to have to consider what to do about this. In the report that we did, and we had consultants providing the information for us, expert in this field, they actually looked and said, yes, we could build a retention wall where we are today, But in 25, 30 years' time, the sea will have eroded around the edges of that and start to then erode the land behind the wall. You'd have to do major works to keep the wall into reasonably good order, because we're talking about a sort of a rock wall face. And of course, the problem then is that we would have to then totally rebuild that wall after a period of more years. So the view is taken that, in fact, if you're going to do anything to protect the village, and I suspect in years to come that will be the important question, it's when you do it. And if you're going to build such a retention wall, that timing is very important. So yes, it may well be in 100 years' time that the generations of that time have to make that decision. What we're saying at the moment is we should do what we can to manage and, if like, try and slow down the erosion as best we can by using other means. And the way to manage it was, in fact, to look at proper drainage, stopping agricultural works carrying on right up to the edge of the cliff face, possibly some planting of special shrubs and grass that would actually help hold the area together. I mean, it is a difficult situation because, of course, this cliff face in this area is actually sand-based, so it's really quite erosive.
Do you think, at the end of the day, you can stop the erosion?
I don't think that man can really quite easily stop the sea. The force of the sea is very, very powerful. And if the land all the way into the village is of the same nature, then the erosion will continue, as it has done for the last 200 or 300 years. We are now some way back to where the coastland used to be. And of course, we know many properties have over the years fallen into the sea. So nothing is unfortunately going to change. But what we can do is maybe look to manage it and make a concerted effort at an appropriate time, which may safeguard the village.
It might be possible to try and protect this area of coast below Kirkmichael by building a huge rock armour wall, rather like the breakwater in Douglas, with its concrete stabbets that help absorb and deflect the power of the waves. But not only would it look horrible along this coast and cost millions of pounds, there's also another problem. We've already seen at the gabions further up the coast how the sea can get in behind these structures, and such a wall, which would have to end somewhere, might actually make matters worse. The armour would merely deflect the energy of the waves elsewhere along the coast. The existing rock armour, giant granite blocks from Foxdale, does protect the land above it, but it leaves the bits in between very exposed. The fish farm here at Glenwillan is now teetering on the edge, and the land on either side of the armour is eroding as fast as ever, leaving the protected parts standing proud like promontories. It's interesting to note, though, that wherever there is armour, the cliffs directly above are sprouting vegetation, which is helping to stabilise and consolidate them. So the armour does work. It's just the expense and the uncertain effect elsewhere on the coast that's the problem.
But whilst all the discussions take place and Tim Wall debates the issues and the consultants make recommendations, well, the sea waits for no one. It's busy moving the beach. We've seen how erosion is causing a real problem for a lot of people along this coast, and how any scheme to try and stop it would be costly, unsightly, and might not be very effective. But as strange as it seems with all this talk of erosion, there are parts of this coast that are actually accumulating material, and we've got something called longshore drift to thank for that. Longshore drift is an action of the tide, and it actually moves sand and pebbles along the shore. As the waves break up onto the beach, they break at an angle and then pull straight back. So as they do so, they push the stones up onto the beach this way and then pull them straight back. Push them onto the beach this way and then pull them straight back. As each successive wave repeats this action, it zigzags the stones along the shore.
The breaking wave is called the swash, and as the wave runs back into the sea, it's called the backwash. Now, these have different energies. The swash is much stronger and will carry the heavier stones up the beach. But now the wave's energy is exhausted, and the backwash is nowhere near as strong and can only pull the smaller stones back. This means that the larger stones tend to end up higher up on the beach, with the smaller stones and the sand nearer the sea. But of course, not every tide is the same. Sometimes, in storm conditions or very high tides, the water will come much higher up the beaches, right to the foot of the cliffs, and the larger stones will find themselves on the move again. One of the best places to see stones sorted like this is Douglas Beach. Here, near the sea wall, are the larger stones pushed up by the swash. The less powerful backwash has only been able to pull back the smaller stones, which are lower down the beach. The occasional larger stone in this area is probably on its way up to the other large stones, moving a little further with each tide. It's a constant cycle on all beaches, and on the west coast, as the cliffs collapse, more sand and more stones are brought down, and successive high tides will move this material as well.
So we know the sea is taking all this material away from here and moving it along the beach. But where's it all going? Is there a huge pile of stones and sand somewhere up north? Well, actually, there is, and there are some strange things happening up there. This is one of the most extraordinary landscapes on the Isle of Man. It's the Point of Ayre, and it's the most northerly tip of the island, which juts out into the Irish Sea over there. Scotland is just a few miles north, and in fact, I'm closer to Scotland here than I am to Douglas. This beautiful building behind me is the Point of Ayre Lighthouse. It's over 180 years old, and it was built in 1818, as so many ships were getting wrecked passing the point with its turbulent currents. Although since then, things haven't worked out quite as expected. Ships were still running aground here, especially during fog when it was difficult to see the light. So 70 years after the lighthouse was put here, this foghorn was built, with two great horns on the roof which blasted a mighty cord out to sea through the mist. But there was still a problem. As the years had passed, it was found the original lighthouse was no longer on the shore. Something strange was happening. The Point of Ayre was getting bigger. Therefore, a radical solution was needed. Let me introduce you to the Winky. Well, the Winky is this special little light that was built here on the beach at the point, and it flashes on and off every 3 seconds, hence its name. It was built here at the same time as the foghorn, because by 1888 so many more stones had appeared that the original lighthouse was effectively inland, and not much use really for telling ships where the coast was anymore.
Indeed, in these rare fragments of archive footage from the middle of the last century, we see a vessel run aground at the point. Sailing past at night, ships could easily think they were a safe distance from the lighthouse, but because the Point of Ayre was growing, they were often misled and ran aground. Even today, ships come very close to the point to avoid the nearby currents. It's easy to see that in the dark they could be misled by a lighthouse that wasn't where it should be.
The
the Winkey seemed like the perfect solution, but the point is growing so fast that it had to be moved, because originally it used to be further back. In fact, another 80 metres further back. So in 1950, it was moved to here. But who knows how long it'll stay here. Footage shot in 1949 shows the Winkey in its original position next to the foghorn. And this photograph from around 1910 shows it next to the original foghorn with just one horn. You can just see the sea glistening in the background, showing that at that time the Winkey in its original position was right on the edge of the beach. There must be hundreds of millions of stones here as far as the eye can see, and there's more turning up every day. But the peculiar thing is that they're pretty much all the same size. There's no sand or gravel, and there's no really big boulders. They're all about this size. So the question is, where are they coming from and how are they being sorted? If you stand right on the tip here, you can see the strong currents pulling past. They run up the west coast, swirl past here and go off in a great curve to the southeast. Over there is a marker buoy which warns shipping of dangerous sandbanks just a few metres below the surface. And the action of the tide is key to what's happening here. The current pulls the sand with it out to sea, which is why there's none on the beach here. But what it isn't strong enough to do is move the big boulders that are on the seabed. But what it does do, especially when it's stormy, is pick up these types of stones and throw them up here, producing a massive shingle beach, which is growing bigger by the year. So, the longshore drift is pulling these stones up the western coast and dumping them here. And if you look at the point of air from above, you can clearly see what's happening. The original lighthouse is now away from the shoreline, and the foghorn and the auxiliary light are now in the front line as the point continues to grow. And whilst this huge bank of stones is growing above water, the sand is growing underwater. This map of the Irish Sea, showing the contours of the seabed, clearly shows giant sand dunes off the northeast of the point. So this is where the western beaches are ending up, cleverly sorted into stones marked by the lighthouses and sand dunes marked by the buoy. Well, those marvellous lighthouses aren't the only point of interest up here, because just south of the Winkey is something that can only be described as the Stinky, and it's right here. This is Wright's Pit East. It's the island's current landfill site, or the tip as we all know it. And until the island's incinerator comes online, it's where we bury all our rubbish. And trust me, on a warm day, you want to be as far away from it as possible. Unless you're a seagull, of course. Now we know that the point of air is getting bigger, but just a short way down the coast towards Ramsey, the story is quite different. At Cranstall, there once stood some cottages, but in the 1960s and 70s, they gradually fell into the sea. And all that's left here now is the road that once led to them. It must have been very dispiriting for the owners to have to watch the gradual collapse of their homes as the sea undermined the gardens. And no doubt this would have happened to David Greenwood's house if he hadn't surrounded it with granite blocks. There's something else to note here as well. Because the north of the island is sand and gravel, and there's no stone to quarry for building, people often use the larger stones from the beaches for their walls. Here, though, the sea is claiming them back.
Indeed, in 1946, a 3 kilometre stretch of this coast, 2 metres wide, was ripped away one night in a violent storm. So how safe is this bit of coast? Now, the experts assure us that this section of the coast isn't eroding, although it is midpoint between the severe erosion south of me at Cranstall and the ever-advancing beach north of me at the Point of Ayre. And the sea is unpredictable. So who knows when a violent storm may come and take advantage of a weakness like this and start ripping into the landscape. But the Department of the Environment has a plan.
When the tip is full, it'll be covered over with earth and planted, and it's hoped that the heath will return, the heather and the gorse will grow again, and within a generation, people will have forgotten what was here.
And that's the problem. In 50 or 100 years' time, no one is going to remember that there's thousands of tons of rubbish buried here. And if the coast erodes up to where I'm standing, what'll happen? Well, the department tell me that they're going to bury giant concrete markers at each corner. So if the coast erodes, they'll be exposed, revealing a sign saying something to the effect of, "If you can read this, please ring the Department of the Environment." Now, if there still is a department that far in the future, will the person answering the phone have any idea what that sign is referring to? Let's hope so, because as the first 1,000 plastic bags go washing out to sea, it's probably too late to do anything about it. Man's efforts to hold back the sea have never been much more successful than King Canute in the 11th century. And here on the Isle of Man, the government and many landowners will have to face the inevitable consequences of coastal erosion and the relentless sea. Hello. It's been 7 years since I filmed the sections that make up the earlier part of this DVD, and I thought it would be a good idea to go back over the issues that were raised back in 2003 and see what's changed in the areas of coastal erosion and government policy. At the time, I was able to show you some of the northern coastal areas of the Isle of Man that were eroding, and speak to a politician about the consultant's report on the effects of coastal erosion and the options for dealing with it. I've come back to some of the places we visited first time round to see if coastal erosion has had any effect and whether the predictions in that report have in fact come true. And now there's another element that's very much on the agenda, global warming. In a moment, we'll speak to someone who will give us their assessment on the effect that this will have on the Isle of Man. But first, let's visit some of the places we highlighted as being vulnerable to coastal erosion. Let's see how they've been getting on. In 2003, I spoke to David Greenwood, who lived at Carlin Mill, a small house perched on the northwest coast whose garden had been washed away in a great storm in 1990. David had put his own rock armour in front of his garden to try and protect his land. How well has that worked? This great pile of rocks is still here, so the garden above is still safe. Yet, it's the land either side that's definitely suffered. And if we go around the other side, we can see just what's been happening. It's well known that structures like this can actually increase coastal erosion. And here's how it works. If this line represents the sand cliffs behind me, and this rock, the rock armour, then when the tide comes in from this direction, the rock armour makes it swirl around and dissolve the cliff, speeding up the rate of erosion. When I was last here 7 years ago, this cliff had a distinctive curve, and this headland came out to pretty much where I'm walking now. It just goes to show how dramatic the effects of coastal erosion have been in this area in recent years. 7 years ago, I took you further along the coast here to see someone else's attempt at stopping coastal erosion below their house. Let's see how they're getting on. I showed you the gabions, wire baskets filled with stones that the owner had placed at the bottom of the cliff at huge expense. The cliff above them was green with vegetation, the roots of which were helping to stabilise the cliff. But look at it now. The sea has almost completely destroyed the gabions. What's left of them now stand even further from the cliff. It's not that they've moved, rather that the sea has swirled in behind them, washing the cliffs away. The farm above is now closer to the edge, and since filming from the helicopter, there's been another major collapse of the cliff onto the beach, as the sea eats away at the cliff's base. Talking of being close to the edge, this report, prepared by consultants for the Manx government 10 years ago, gives detailed estimates as to how long they think threatened properties have got until they fall into the sea. It makes rather interesting reading. For example, Ballateer was predicted to start falling into the sea in 12 years' time. That was 11 years ago, so in effect, it is just 1 year to go. Other properties were predicted to fall into the sea in 6 or 7 years, so by now, they should have gone. In fact, they haven't. One of them, of course, was Carlin Mill, but we can see that the owner's work to protect it has given it a stay of execution. Here at Glen Willen, the Clearwater trout farm was predicted to have gone 2 years ago. But, as we can see, it's still down there. Though if you compare it to the footage we took in 2003, it is nearer the edge, and the small pond has all but gone. So, you can see, predicting the rates of coastal erosion isn't an exact science. It does work both ways, though. Although rates have been slower than expected during the last 10 years, a sudden tidal surge during a wild winter storm can make up for that and rip huge sections of coast away. And no one knows when that might happen. In some places, a surge in coastal erosion can have a catastrophic effect. I'm travelling to the northern tip of the island, to just such a place. I was here 7 years ago, and if there has been a substantial increase in erosion since then we've got a problem.
This is the site of Wright's Pit East. Now, I don't know whether Mr. Wright's happy or not that he's got a rubbish dump named after him, but it does look rather smart, since it was closed and landscaped in 2005. This is how it looked when we were last here. Tens of thousands of tons of rubbish being dumped and levelled. All the bin wagons on the island had to drive up here each day to empty their load. We don't do that anymore because we now have a shiny new incinerator. The bin wagons now come here from all over the island and dump the rubbish into a huge concrete-lined pit. A giant claw mixes this up and lifts the rubbish into a chute, which leads to the incinerator itself. The burning waste produces heat, which is used to generate electricity. And the bottom ash and bits of metal are all that remain to be disposed of. It's good news for the environment here, as this giant landfill site has been covered over and landscaped. And in a few short years, the heathland will return, and you'd hardly ever know it was here. Or would you? The problem is, it's very close to the sea. And the question surely has to be how long until the erosion starts to eat away at the side of this buried rubbish. The coast up here is moving in two directions. The actual point of air is growing each year as more stones are deposited, and it's growing in a southerly direction. But just down from the point, it's a different story. The coast is slowly eroding. From the air, Wright's Pit East is now a large pale rectangle, and its bottom left-hand corner is perilously close to the beach. But how much has gone since I last filmed here? Well, this is very interesting. First, let me remind you of where I spoke from in 2003. Now, the experts assure us that this section of the coast isn't eroding, although it is midpoint between the severe... I was sat right here. And as you can see, this area is eroding. Nothing major, but these cliffs are definitely on the move. The problem is, this loose sand and shingle is easily dislodged by wind and rain, let alone the battering from a stormy high tide. Although less than a metre has gone in 8 years, there's no doubt that there is steady erosion. And don't forget that catastrophic event in 1946, when a violent storm took 2 metres of coast away over a distance of 3 kilometres in one night. So, it seems clear that the coast is eroding towards the edge of Wright's Pit East. It's difficult to say how long this could take, but at some point in the future, the sea might be lapping up against the edge of this landfill site. And at this point in time, if nothing is done, then thousands of tons of rubbish could be washing out to sea. In 2003, the Department of the Environment told me that they had buried great concrete markers at the edge of the tip that would be revealed if the land eroded to that point. In fact, they decided to go for these markers instead. When the eroding coast gets to here, then someone has to take action. I don't know what the options would be, maybe moving all the tons of rubbish to somewhere else, or even taking it to the incinerator. But it would be a massive task. The heath will grow over all of this, and in a few years' time, you'll never know it was here. But I am assured it's on government maps and being constantly monitored. But as erosion is a real issue, this could be a major problem for future generations. So what other developments have there been since 2003? Well, there has been one very big development here in Kirkmichael, and it's very controversial. These houses were built in 2005, and the development was nicknamed the King Canute Estate by the local commissioners, because the houses have been built on land that is so close to the sea. According to this report, this land could be threatened in just 50 years if coastal erosion rates speed up from what they have been recently. And what nobody knows is whether global warming will have any effect on all of this. But we'll talk more about that in a moment. You can see from the aerial shots the large empty field before 2005. Now look at it again since that time, with the houses built, much to the local commissioner's surprise and annoyance. They opposed the application by Dandara, and John Barron, who was a member of Kirkmichael Commissioners at the time, told me why it was so controversial.
The main controversy was the amount of coastal erosion that has happened in the last 50 years, and this land has been under threat. And we were very concerned that if they built houses on this land in another 30 years' time, they would be under threat as well.
What was your reaction when planning permission was granted for this estate?
The commissioners were very surprised that they actually got permission to build here. We were shocked, actually, that the inspector gave the go-ahead for them to be built. There's so much land around here that could be built on to give the go-ahead here, and especially first-time buyers' houses. We opposed it on the grounds of the erosion, of the land, and the amount of erosion that's happened in the last 50 years. It's just continuous. And we were very concerned that if it was built here in another 30 years, these houses would be under threat. I've been here over 50 years now, lived all my life here. There was fields and there was an old mill down here. There was a bungalow that had to be demolished. There's quite two or three fields all beyond there that has disappeared in the last 50 years.
The government's view is buyer beware. Do you think that's a fair attitude?
Well, it probably is now, but originally, I think if you can't trust the government planners, it's not really fair on the people that's actually bought houses here that are under threat now. I mean, the government should be responsible enough to say no, that you can't build here. But if they say, oh yes, you can build and it's up to you to worry about it afterwards, I don't think it's fair on the actual people that's bought the houses. So I think they do have a responsibility to the people that bought these houses to try and protect them in some way.
In the end, it's the government's responsibility for ever allowing those houses to be built in the first place. John Shimon is the Minister for Environment, Food and Agriculture. And I asked him why this development has been allowed.
I think that's one of the dilemmas for government and people, particularly in an island. When developers are keen to develop properties and there's a demand for them, then we have to look at what is going to be the likelihood of that property being affected in the future. We have only created one management zone, which is in the Kirkmichael area, to ensure that no developments will take place within an area of the coast. The one you're talking about is further inland, inevitably may be under vulnerable threat within 100 years plus. However, we could sterilise too much of the land just in case. So we try and get that balance between allowing development to take place, but ensuring that the information is available for purchasers of properties to see if they decide it's worth the risk.
So when it comes down to it, the bottom line, whose responsibility is it? Is it government's responsibility or is it the individual's?
I think the government has an enormous responsibility to protect the infrastructure of the Isle of Man. I think individuals have a responsibility to protect their own assets. Now, we will attempt to try and ensure that developments don't take place in those areas that are going to be prone to erosion. And we're not dealing with this on the Isle of Man alone. This is a problem for all coastal areas. The real unknown in this is the speed of the damage that could be caused by the climate change and the rising of the sea levels. So that's something which everybody has to take into account. We have already taken action to make sure that there's a protected area in the Kirkmichael area, and I think we'll have to do that further in the future. And the balance, to answer your question, is the government has responsibility to all the taxpayers of the Isle of Man, and individuals have responsibility for their own decisions.
You've mentioned the Coastal Management Act in 2005. Is it the long-term view of the government to actually manage the coast instead of protecting it?
It actually allows government to take action in areas that are prone to coastal erosion. So we are aware that in certain areas we still require infrastructure. Individuals still have the right and the need to do certain things in these areas. Most of this land is in private ownership by farmers or people who have a right to use that land. What it does, it means that we've got an element of control to make sure that they confer with the Department of Government in order to make sure that what they do is not going to cause an adverse effect. I think we have to remember that we're talking about 50 or 100 years ahead, and if we look back on what the changes are on the Isle of Man and technology over that period of time, I think the next 50 to 100 years are going to challenge mankind to find solutions to some of these problems. Therefore, I don't know what the answer will be, but certainly all coastal areas that are vulnerable are trying to look for solutions, and mankind are have great ingenuity in trying to come forward with a better solution. I think the big danger is actually putting in current measures of protection, which actually just move the problem further down the coast.
Of course, one thing that the report written in 2000 didn't take into account was the effect of global warming. You'll be aware that there's a great deal of controversy about whether the warming is man-made or not, and a great deal of uncertainty about its speed and the exact effect it will have. There are all sorts of scenarios, but the wildest predictions would have large portions of the Isle of Man underwater in just 100 years. In fact, the northern plain, deposited during the last ice age, would eventually be washed away. And as you looked out from the northern hills, there would only be sea. And where the TT course runs along the bottom of those hills, there would once again be a beach. But if global warming leads to an increase in winds, rain and storms, which is one of the scenarios, then the erosion around the Isle of Man will only get faster, and the time left for the houses at Kirkmichael will only become shorter. So to get an expert view on the possible effects of global warming on the island, I've come to see Emeritus Professor Trevor Norton, marine biologist and critically acclaimed author. I asked him if global warming would in fact affect coastal erosion here on the Isle of Man.
Almost certainly, yes it will. The two factors that are most important in coastal erosion are the height of the waves and the frequency of the storms. And all the predictions are that both those things will increase in the near future. And they're going to do it quite substantially. It's obvious that sea level, for example, will go up because if there's warming in the atmosphere, the sea will get warmer, it'll expand. If it expands, it'll rise. And there's all this water locked up as ice in glaciers and ice caps. And as that starts to melt, where does it go? It goes into the sea. So it's certain to go up.
So what sort of rises are we looking at? What do the predictions say? How much of a rise in sea level are we going to get?
Well, remember that sea level's not actually a static thing. It has been fairly static recently, but in the past it's varied really very widely. During the peak of the Ice Age, the level of the sea was 120 metres lower than it is now. That Irish elk that's in the Manx Museum didn't swim across here from Ireland, it walked. It's as simple as that. And when the ice began to melt, it melted at a tremendous rate and the sea started to rise again. It was melting at the rate of 4 metres every century. That's the amount of rise in the sea level from that time. So it's very, very substantial.
So looking towards the future then, how much of a rise are we going to see here on the Isle of Man?
Well, it's very, very difficult to give you a definitive answer because every time they do add something to their models, the prediction goes up. But the current prediction, which is very recent, is that they reckon that within this century it will go up by a metre and possibly even by 2 metres.
So if we're looking at a metre, if I say that to somebody, oh, it's only about this high, that doesn't sound very much.
No, but you've got to remember that in a storm, an extra metre on top of the waves is hugely amplified and makes a big difference. And one of the problems that the other prediction of climate change is that storms, the weather will be much more extreme, we'll have drier, hotter summers apparently, but we'll have winters which are much wetter and where there are far more storms. And what they're predicting is those storms that come only once every 50 years, a really big storm, will become much more frequent, and perhaps even as frequent as every 6 or 7 years. Now that means the rate at which a wave will chomp away at cliffs is going to be hugely increased.
So for the young people watching this programme, are they going to see these kind of changes and these effects in their lifetime?
I would have thought so. If, as predicted, we'll have perhaps a half a metre rise by 50 years hence, then I think they'll see the headlines in the paper about land missing in the northwest of the island, and that'll be in the papers almost every day, I suspect. And if this frequency of storms increases, as it's supposed to, then they'll hardly miss the windows rattling in the storm and the roof tiles being made into frisbees. First year I came to the island, that's exactly what happened to me. I thought, where on earth have I come to? And every one of the students I taught, I said, what will you remember about the island? The first thing they said was, the wind. So storms are a thing we've already got in abundance. And if it gets worse, you'll certainly notice it.
So that's a look at what's happened over the last 7 years, since I made the earlier part of this programme. Coastal erosion is still at work, changing the coast, threatening properties, and causing problems for residents and for government. And it remains to be seen what will happen when coastal erosion starts to threaten the Kirkmichael housing estates. Meanwhile, just to give you an idea of what might be involved if the Manx government decided to protect the several kilometres of coast at Kirkmichael, take a look at the recent runway extension safety area project at Ronaldsway Airport. Although the scheme was to extend the coast rather than to protect it, it would mean a similar engineering project to absorb the energy of the sea and save the sand cliffs. Huge barges were towed over from Norway, which had a supply of the particular type of rock required. 185,000 tons of it. The barges were held in position by a tug whilst the rocks were offloaded and placed at the perimeter of the site, making it into a giant lagoon. The average weight of the rocks was 20 tons, but some of them weighed nearly 50 tons. After all the rock armour was in place, the old yellow gantry was removed and the site was lined, after which it was filled with sand. This was an extraordinary spectacle. A specially adapted vessel had sucked 324,000 cubic metres of sand off the floor of Morecambe Bay in northwest England and delivered it into the lagoon. A group of bulldozers spread the sand evenly around the site, and it all looked so remarkable that even the airport firemen turned out to watch. The whole site was levelled and tarmacked, and now looks like it was always there. But even this small scheme cost over £23 million, so just imagine how much it would cost to save the coast at Kirkmichael.